I titled this The Bridge Project, and basically it's an opportunity to cover linear perspective, typically two-point perspective. The goal is to create a landscape that explores the idea of who you are now and who you want to become. I reference this as an island and then a mainland and a bridge that bridges the two together. So the island is you now. The island is made up of your family, your ethnicity, citizenship, of course the country that we live in, your physical build, your socioeconomic background and gender. So these things that you don't necessarily choose, these are the things that are predetermined for you. And so first thing to do is kind of self-actualize and realize who you are. And then you'll want to think through where you want to go. What's that goal, that mainland that you want to head to? And those goals can be very diverse. They could explore career is kind of the obvious one, but it also could explore your spiritual autonomy, family, friends, whether you want to get married someday or not, have children, how you want to handle your leisure time, hobbies, even your critical thinking skills and the kind of person you want to become. So it's wide open as you think through who you are now and how you want to evolve into this other person, this adult. And then the bridge itself is, how do you get there? How do you achieve and become this person that you want to become? So the obvious answers to this would be, you know, things like hard work and effort, researching the goal thoroughly, look for patterns, observe how other people are achieving some of those same goals that you're looking for, and character development of just becoming the person that you want to become and avoiding pitfalls and obstacles to what you want to do. The design itself, even though I talk about it as being a bridge project, most students will go a wide variety of different directions with this. And I would say start with a bridge. So start with a quick sketch right now, where you draw an island and you draw a bridge and you draw a mainland and you start writing and filling in information that explores these ideas. But then you really want to push symbology and don't go with obvious symbols, but go with very personal symbols. And what does the design work need to look like for this? Examples by students and stuff that I've done where I've pushed beyond the bridge into a whole nother realm. Before you start exploring out the specifics of the picture, you want to really think through symbology of, like, how do you build symbols that deal with you? An example, in one of my paintings, I incorporated a lighthouse that was burning. When I was a kid, the Miss Pelion lighthouse burned down, and I had drawn it numerous times. And it kind of represented the end of childhood, in a sense, is this lighthouse burning down. If I put a lighthouse burning in one of my paintings or pictures, it wouldn't mean anything to you. It's a personal symbol. It's not a universal. But that's really the direction I want you to go with this. Your goal isn't to necessarily clearly communicate to me. The goal is for you to clearly explore yourself and self-actualize. I want this to be deeply personal, so you're welcome to put information in the drawing that you wouldn't want to share. Or you never have to talk about anything that you don't want to talk about that's in a picture. But this is really where symbolism is really important, because you don't have to use the actual situation. Everything can be symbolized in different ways. I've got a lot of material on my website that you can look through that helps you walk through each step. Many of you in your different classes have had to explore your dreams and so on, and I understand that this isn't a unique exercise for you to do, but it is unique in visualizing it, and that whole process of visualizing your goals has a benefit to it. My goal is that you create something that will be fun for you someday to dig up and show your grandkids and friends, and realize how much your views have changed and your goals have changed.
My father could have been a great comedian, but he didn't believe that that was possible for him. And so he made a conservative choice. Instead, he got a safe job as an accountant. And when I was 12 years old, he was let go from that safe job. And our family had to do whatever we could to survive. I learned many great lessons from my father, not the least of which was that you can fail at what you don't want. So you might as well take a chance on doing what you love.
To get started, I'd like for you to spend some time talking to family and friends, parents, and ask them how their goals have changed over the years, and walk them through the different questions that I'm asking you. Throw them these questions and explore them out with your family. I think you'll learn a lot about your parents by doing this, and I think it will help you show your parents your goals, at least the ones that you feel comfortable with, and see how they respond to it, and see if they see some of those same interests and traits in you. Some of you have taken Myers-Briggs personality tests. This would be a good time to spend writing and just exploring through journaling, thinking through some of these personality tests that you've taken in the past. I'm posting an article about how your generation may be a little different than mine, and that might be of help to you. You know, your personality can be identified in lots of interesting and sometimes peculiar ways. So spend some time at the beginning of this project writing. Our economic system is not perfectly fair, and as a nation, we're working on it. Equal pay for equal work is something that you hear a lot of, and it is very important, and we're still not where we need to be, but we're working towards equity. You're in a unique situation that you can actually have a dream that you could probably fulfill. There's very little setting you back. I've been to places like Manchay in Peru, that's a hot desert, and if you're born there to dream of being an architect, the odds of you getting the education and being able to fulfill that are much slimmer than living in the United States. So you're in a great situation where you can actually make goals and probably fulfill a lot of those. And that even includes those of you that have physical issues. And I'm going to put a clip in here of an Olympic runner who had all kinds of physical issues, and she just pushed through. You really want to become a person who pushes through those weaknesses. Arnold Schwarzenegger talked about in his training that he would try to push through those weaknesses. So if he had specific muscles that were weaker, he would try to make those his asset and work those out to become stronger. And that's how he created kind of asymmetry in his bodybuilding routines. When you say, I'm nervous about public speaking, or I don't write well, and you opt out, it just becomes a bigger weakness, rather than something you work through. And of course, as an art teacher, I hear this a lot from people that they say, oh, I can't draw. And obviously drawing is something they could learn to do, and it's okay that they don't learn it, but it is a weakness. And if they push through that, they would find wonderful ways to use drawing if they push that and develop that skill out. The world is changing, and jobs that we once, everyone felt like were safe jobs, have become obsolete, and your job market in 30 years will look very different than my imagination will allow me to explore. As a teacher, I try to be humble when I'm making suggestions to students, and if you're ever around a guidance counselor or an adult or a teacher who seems to know kind of where the job market will be in the future, I would be suspect, because when I was in high school, the web was something a spider did, and I had no clue how much the art world would change. I used a waxer and X-Acto knife, and computers were not a main part of what we did as designers and artists. So things are changing, and I know high school guidance counselors made advice to some of my friends in high school, telling them if they just did some certain things that they would have job security forever, and those jobs don't even exist anymore. So you'll need to be resilient. One of the worst movies ever made, even though it's very entertaining, is Karate Kid. Mr. Miyagi trains a young man to become an expert in a relatively short time, and that's really not the way work ethic and effort works. It is an unbelievable amount of effort, and that is job security, is to really push your abilities and your effectiveness in what you do, and that takes a lot of time and effort. Failure is part of this whole process, and as students over the years, many years, I've assigned this project, and students that have drawn the project you're working on have become terminally ill, have gone through heartbreaking divorces, and been hit by drunk drivers, and failed out of college, and developed drug addictions, and so. But also, people have done great things, become art directors, have worked on wonderful design projects, and have had beautiful families, and so on. Failure is part of life. It's not something we pursue, but how you handle failure is going to be important. And you may even include that. So, for example, in the island, in the mainland idea, it's possible that the water itself, the rocks and so on, or the atmosphere, or maybe even how the bridge is structured, that there is some holes on that bridge that suggest that it's not going to be an easy ride. And how you handle that, those setbacks, are important. I remember once a woman telling me that she was really close to becoming a famous country music singer, and and the reason she felt that way in her head was because she never even started the journey. She talked about almost buying bus tickets to go to Nashville, but never did. So she didn't even start the journey. She didn't really truly have a chance to fail. And failure is a beautiful thing, because it means you're engaged in the goal. And how you handle failure is as important as those wins. One word we don't use much in our culture is the word laziness and sloth, and it's almost, for some reason, a politically incorrect word. Sloth and laziness are the real killers for you achieving your goals. A lot of students want to get paid with a grade for work that's not hardly worth looking at, and adults want to get paid for a job that's not well done. Laziness and sloth is, in some ways, it's like theft. When I'm working at festivals, sometimes the people that are supposed to be cleaning up the festival will sit under a tree for hours. And not only is it sloth and laziness, but it's theft. And I've seen police officers that are making time and a half will do the same thing. It's not a socioeconomic situation. You could be wealthy or poor, and it has nothing to do with who you are as a person. You're always pushing that range of what should you be doing and what is fair. Laziness actually affects you more than it affects anybody else, because it it inhibits your ability to push and to become all that you can be. So regardless of what job you have, even if it's a fast food place, if you work twice as hard, you're becoming a better person, even if you could get by with taking smoke breaks every 30 minutes. So think through that in your picture of how do you explore work ethic in your art. This is a bit of a quirky part of my talk, but the luck aspect, and as you look to your left and right, you'll see sometimes people will get opportunities that you didn't get, and it happens. It's your work ethic that's going to be the key, but every once in a while you'll get lucky or someone else will get lucky with an opportunity. I remember when I actually got this job, a friend of mine had made comments that I was lucky that I had jumped into this job immediately right out of college. What he didn't know is that I had volunteered for many hours without pay here at this school to help a fellow teacher who was teaching in two different rooms and needed help in a painting class. So I would come in as a college student a couple times a week and work with those painting students for free. This wasn't something I wasn't getting paid for. And so then when the job opportunity came up, she was my advocate. And I had no intention of even staying in Indiana when I did this. I was just trying to be helpful, but she was an advocate for me and helped me get the job then. So what you might feel like is luck might not be. So you might not know the whole story. Putting up an example here of a singer who replaced the lead singer of Boston. And is it luck that this singer got the job? Not so much, actually. It was the fact that his voice sounded exactly like the former lead singer. It's complicated. And then I went to hear this talk by a Disney animator who was talking about working on this chicken character for the film, and he said that it almost got completely scrapped. And when I watched the film, I thought it was one of the best parts of the film. But if it had been completely cut out, it wasn't because he didn't do a good job. He did a great job. You don't always have full control over the situation. So this chart showing how you move from something being a hobby to being a professional, I think spend some time studying it. How do you become a student to a mentor or someone who is contributing to the information that students will someday study? Michael Sweet is a musician, and he's spent his whole life being in bands, and it's fun to be around people that you see that the skill in what they do has been developed. They're excited to be a master at something, and that's really where you want to be, no matter what it is. Hairstylist, engineer, architect, surgeon, like that, you want to be a contributor where you push being the very best daycare provider that anyone has ever seen, and that's where the excitement in what you do comes. Again, keep in mind that things will continue to change. And when I was a computer animator, there was an older gentleman that the company had hired who was still working with the waxer and the X-Acto knife, and just felt like the computer was just too big of an obstacle and wasn't willing to learn it. And so he was almost retired. My boss was merciful and tried to throw him some jobs as he kind of finished up his career. I remember even studying with Milt Neal. You know, he was a great animator, but if you asked him to do much more than put the VHS tape in, he just didn't want to do it and wasn't interested in learning. And he was convinced that computers would never be a major part of animation, something that was such a staple of our culture, like a newspaper that almost every family would get delivered to their home. Now, a minority of homes get a newspaper delivered to their home.
But while part two is being printed, other news stories are still coming in. The Times has a paid circulation of more than 1 million.
Entrepreneurship will probably be a big part of what you do in your future. I shot this photo of a little girl with a lemonade stand. I sold seeds door to door, garden seeds. I sold greeting cards. I hoed peppers. I baled hay. I did all kinds of different things as a kid to make money. It was just what we did. It's possible that you will need to exercise that entrepreneurial spirit rather than looking for someone to hire you. You do have to explore risk, your risk tolerance, because that is part of it. Are you willing to take out a loan? Are you willing to? Would you prefer to just go work for a company, or would you be willing to take the risk to start a company? So I took this photo following a police car that nobody wanted to pass. The question is, who had the biggest risk tolerance? We all have different personalities. My wife and I tend to always be pretty conservative, and we've always tried to live our life more in the fashion of stay out of debt, pay off debt. But other people have been very successful with large debt structures and taking big risks and quitting jobs and moving. And so everybody has a different personality, and you'll have to maybe spend a little bit of time thinking through your personality in regard to risk. What motivates you to work? So as you're thinking through this bridge project, what are the things that are going to make you want to cross that bridge onto the mainland? I've always said, try to create motivation that is as small as possible. So when I'm at an event, I'll start in the morning at 10 o'clock and I'm drawing till 10, 11 o'clock at night at like the state fair. And my reward sometimes is as simple as a Mountain Dew or coffee that I'll say after, you know, at 11 o'clock, I'm going to get a Mountain Dew. And the goal is to make those rewards small. Because if you say, I'm going to do 30 minutes worth of homework and then play video games for 5 hours, it doesn't work well. And it's a destructive way of approaching it. So ask yourself, what motivates you, and what kind of accountability? Some people need more motherly nurturing. Some people are very independent and self-motivated. Some people need a coach like Chris Farley to almost yell at them to get them to move. And so I, as a teacher, tried to explore all of those. Depending on your personality, I've tried to explore like what motivates you to work.
Now you've been sitting here resting on your laurels thinking, hey, I can take it easy now that Chevy Chase isn't in the picture. Hey, look at me, I'm Conan O'Brien. Put my feet up on the desk and phone in the show. Well, by God, I got a couple of words for you. You better get your act together. My God, he sits there and he thinks it. He's sitting squat-legged listening to some sacred cow. Andy, you keep that up, young fella. You're going to be sitting squat-legged while you're living in a van down by the river. How about you, young fella? You got... out of Big Curtain. Old Biz Curtain. Oh, look at this thing, huh? Well, you keep this curtain around here. I got two things I can do with that. I can towel dry after the shower and wipe my rear end with it. Hey, look at here. Max Weinberg. Hey, Max is going to play a little drum. Hey, big box. Antics won't give you jack squat. We got a heck of a crowd here tonight. Look at this audience. Yes! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! I can't see real good. Looks to me like it's a golf outing. You people, you're going to go back to Fond du Lac, Wisconsin, or wherever you're from. Your neighbors are going to say, hey, say, I heard you went to Conan O'Brien's show. By God, you have a good time? Well, you're going to be sitting there saying, I shoulda, woulda, coulda. Now, old man's going to keep an eye on you, so you better get your act together.
More and more we're realizing that it's not just your ability at being a daycare worker, work at a barber shop, an engineer, even an artist, that it, when you're working with people, your social skills are really important. And they may be the most important thing. And so, are you a very needy person? Do you need to be told how to do something multiple times? Do you clean up after yourself? You're getting your coffee, do you leave a mess behind you? So social skills are all those things that your parents have been trying to teach you in terms of appropriate behavior around the house, but also just, are you, you know, do you listen well? This little clip's from Dumb and Dumber, and this is obviously two people with lacking social skills. But think through, like, how do social skills fit into your bridge project, and what are some areas you need to work on?
My car died, and I'm late for a luncheon.
We usually don't pick up hitchhikers. But I'm gonna go with my instinct on this one. Saddle up, partner. You're it. Quincy's.
Any Quincy's.
You're it, Quincy's. No, any Quincy's, no Starcy's.
You can't do that.
Can't do.
Cannot. Stamped it.
Can't do. Double stamped it. No erases.
Cannot. Triple stamped it. No erases. Touch
no,
blue, make
no,
it true.
No. You can't triple stamp a double stamp. You can't triple stamp a double stamp, Lloyd. You can't triple stamp a double stamp. Lloyd! You
guys! Enough!
Hey, want to hear the most annoying sound in the world?
Guys!
So maybe just to get started, take a few minutes to look at these bridges and think through how these bridges from different cultures have a different feel to them. And like I said, you don't have to do a bridge for your final project, but this is a good place to start as you're thinking through, again, who am I today? Where do I want to be in the future? How do I get there? Your project does not need to take place in today's culture. It could be science fiction. It could be primitive. I want to see your creativity with this. But as we get started, take a few minutes just to look at these bridges. Some of you have tried to work on homework with your cell phone out and Netflix on and two friends sitting there eating potato chips next to you, and it doesn't work. There's this idea called with-itness, of understanding how things work and how you work within that system. And when you try to win at a game that you can't win, and that's why I have this picture of this gambling game that actually you can't ever win playing it. Your ability to become successful is going to be determined on how you navigate and you understand patterns in your behavior and other people. I have students that I know, I can tell them, I need you to map that picture over there. When it comes back, they've watched me do it enough that they will come back and it'll be perfect. They'll have it taped up, it'll be cut perfectly. And I have other students who have been exposed to the same amount of information, maybe even more, and I know they will cut it wrong and they will need help. And then still by the time it's done, it will be way off. And they'll even ask multiple questions through the whole process. That's not somebody I want to hire. And I know we're sending students out into the workforce. Over the past few weeks, it's been amazing to me how needy some students are and then how little they produce. It's almost as if they feel like by emailing me a lot and asking me to be clearer with the instructions, that will prove that they're working. And I'll have other students that read the instructions and they may have a question or two, but they move forward fast and hard and they're with it. That's who you want to be. You want to be a with it student and you want to be a with it adult. Your ability to be successful is going to be contingent on your stamina, your ability to work for hours and figure out a system that functions well for you. So I like this fight scene because the one guy is a showman, right? He's all talk. He's got skills and he's ready to let everybody know. And the other guy is methodical. So sometimes your ability, your stamina is really going to be knowing where to put your effort and your energy. Do you spend an hour cleaning up your room and then doing your homework? Or do you try to keep your room clean as you go and do your homework? So your ability to be efficient and be productive is going to be huge. How does that play out into a company? Honestly, a company that can make money with you will want to hire you. When you come into a interview, they're looking at you trying to figure out, do you have the stamina? Do you have the work ethic to work here and make us money? Even if it's a service oriented, you're a guy, you're a counselor, you're a fireman. It's all about how efficient and effective you are for them to be able to fiscally be able to bring you on board. If you are, then you're a great candidate for a job. But if you are a lot of work, and you're more work for the people around you, and you're just not very productive, you're going to have a hard time getting a job. And so as you think through your bridge, really think through that aspect of it. How do I become more efficient, and how do I build my stamina and my work?
I always find it helpful to visualize ideas and things, and it helps me think through. So as you are writing and exploring who you are, you also, as you draw things out, I think it really does help. So here's the island, here's the mainland. And again, this is just starting simple. This is who you are, this is your identity, and I go through lots of different stuff in the curriculum where I explore out those issues of what it means for you to be in your family, socioeconomic background, and so on. And then this is your goal, this is where you're trying to go. And this bridge, and I spent a lot of time on this video talking about steps to take to push work ethic, developing your skills, social skills, and so on, that will all help you get to this mainland and achieve the things that you want to achieve in life. So everybody's going to start with a bridge as a quick sketch. Some people will land on that later because they just like the idea so much, but many of you will go other directions. And I'm not even that concerned about perspective at this point. When you're coming up with your ideas, everything's doodles, everything's just quick sketches and so on. So you're really trying to figure out now what is here. And again, this is where symbology comes in. So this tree may be symbolic. If I put a willow tree in the picture, that was the name of our farm, it's Twin Willow Farm. So if I put a willow tree in, that would be symbolic for me. And maybe even a cow. My dad ran a butcher shop. And so I just start throwing in things that would be specific to me. The more specific your symbols can be, the better, because it's just going to be more interesting than if you put I'm for love and a Christian, you put a big cross. Those are not going to be as interesting and specific to you. So you have to figure out, what does love mean to you, and what are those relationships, or what does money? I've had a lot of students put big dollar signs on the mainland, and that's so generic, it just doesn't help us go anywhere, and it's not visually interesting. So you ask yourself, how do I want to make money? And students have used things like hot air balloons or whatever, and you think through what, and you could put motifs and designs on that would explore that out. The one thing that I didn't really talk about yet is the idea that your bridge may not be a singular item. It's possible that your direction would be multiple steps to get to where you want to go. And again, this could even be humorous, and it could be multi-layered. So it's possible this is even a social thing, where you're talking about first being willing to talk to a girl, and then being willing to ask her out, and then being willing to propose, and then get married and have kids or whatever. So you could start off with something very simple like this, but then start fortifying it with, it also means being willing to take out a loan for a business, and then you start the business and so on. So symbology is interesting in that it can be multi-layered, and your symbols can have social meaning, economic meaning, spiritual meanings. And so don't cheat yourself out of the richness that the visuals can provide of that multi-layer meaning. You notice again, I'm using two colors. I like to do this because it gives me that choice of ignoring something. If I put something in, I say, I really don't even want that there or this here, I can leave it out. And I don't like to erase, especially when I'm doing thumbnails. And yeah, I'm putting ladders in. I don't know why. And it's possible that if I was going to put ladders in, this individual is given choices, and this is defying gravity, right? So I'm not sure why, but for some reason, one of their choices is here. And so it's not about a singular thing. They're really deciding between going to dental school or cosmetology school. So, right? So these are really rough drawings, and this is exactly what I want from you. I know most of you in my classes have a decent ability to draw. You like to draw. Very few students like to do this. I've even had students look at my drawings and say, I don't like to scribble. So it's by knocking these things out like this that you can explore out ideas. So you have a choice too, in terms of, do you focus on the who you are now more than where you go? So for example, if you feel a little cloudy about your future and your goals and what you want to major in college, if you do want to go to college, but you self-actualize and you really know who you are and what you like to do, this island here could be the main part, buildings, people, and so on. But the mainland could be foggy and unclear, and it's possible even the bridge is incomplete. It's in construction, right? So that would be an approach. And then you also could say, no, I know what I want to do. I want to be a lawyer, and I know how to get there. I understand law school, and the company I want to work for. I want to have three kids and a husband, and we're gonna picnic on the weekend. So, I mean, you could be real, real specific, have a lot of fun with it. And I wanna have a Jaguar. So you put your car in, put everything, you know, exactly. You could even put your house off in the distance here on a little hill. And again, you notice I'm not too worried about perspective or good figure drawing, really anything, any rules about good drawing are gone. I just want free flow, stream of consciousness as I'm thinking through this stuff. Because if I spend too much time trying to make sure a tree looks good, I'll fall into this being the project that I want to do, and I want to be exploratory. So if your thumbnail takes more than 2 minutes, you're not doing it right. You really need to just keep knocking these out, thinking through. You can even write notes here. Where do you want to live? Again, how many kids? What would the environment look like? What are the pitfalls? Again, and you're just exploring out. But this student will be someone who's clear about their future, and a little cloudier on, or just don't want to put as much emphasis on their past. And this student really wants to talk about, you know, the sports they're in now, their friendships, what they do as a hobby and so on, and maybe start figuring out how they want to build their bridge. Maybe literally they show construction workers building this and they try to figure out like what's that going to be made of. It is possible that your bridge will be removed and you'll figure out other ways to transport yourself. So again, the hot air balloon is a fun idea, paper airplane. So it could be an airplane, I mean, any number of things that transports you from the island or from your place of birth to this location that you're going. So, again, keep everything quick. If you were looking up how to draw a horse during your thumbnail stage, you should not be. I don't care if it looks like a dog. At this early stage, this is you're just trying to get a sense of where you're going. So here we have a horse that's jumping, and where's it jumping from? It's jumping out of a tree. And the tree is full of engravings and fruit that's growing, and this is all suggesting your childhood. And you pick fruit and different types of leaves and branches that all are symbolic of friendships and things you've been involved in. And then where is it going? I have no clue. So it is jumping into a teacup on a big table. And the tea bag says something. I don't know what it says. Your work can have this kind of surrealistic nature. I have sometimes students that will push this, but most are a little too timid. They want everything to be kind of obvious. And so horse is the transportation, becomes the bridge, and jumping out of a tree. It's not real obvious that they're jumping out of a tree. You can flush that out into the teacup, which is a giant teacup. And again, these are all symbols for something. So even though the picture is set up more or less as a landscape, it doesn't mean that you don't put people in it. And in fact, it doesn't have to be a distant view of a landscape. It can be more of a close-up view with people in it. One of the things that's been fun is exploring out the idea of your parents and their relationship in who you become, or you're launching onto your bridge and over to the mainland. So we've explored ideas of the parent kicking the student out the door, more or less, right? We've explored the idea of it being like a paper airplane, where your parents have set you up in a way that you almost just have to kind of float, because they've really, you know, they're paying for college, any number of things, and your job is just to do what you do, right? You already are a good student and you work hard, and so it's going to be an easy transition into adulthood for you, and your parents have set that up. So it's a paper airplane that they just kind of help throw and you just glide along. This is a student that maybe really struggles more with getting homework done and taking on responsibility, and so the parent has to give them the boot. It's possible the right choice is to not even make yourself a person. Maybe you're a chimp and you're going through an obstacle of trees and jungle land. And so let's take that into consideration. And maybe you do want to spend more time thinking of the obstacles. Maybe you feel like your life's been pretty difficult so far. And between physical illness, addiction, any number of things, you really want to focus in on the obstacles you've had and how you've had to kind of work through those. And what does your future look like? Do you feel like your life will continue to be difficult? Do you make it difficult by personal choices, or are these things out of your control? All things to be talking to yourself about, and possibly your family, if you have a chance to discuss some of these things with them. You're divided. What are you divided about? Maybe there's one side of you that's more domesticated, like this beef here, farm animal. And then there's another side of you, leopard, whatever, that's a little more free-spirited. And maybe even it's influencing how you decide on whether you go to college or not and what you major in. So here's a clear divide between two sides of you. Maybe that plays a role in. You know, I'm drawing this really large, but these type of things obviously could fit in a small area of your picture. They don't have to dominate. And you're going to fill your picture with this type of activity. So this is more self-actualization of this cow. And the leopard being kind of divided here. For many students, the pitfall to be successful will be maybe just spending too much time wanting to entertain themselves. But it's possible that it's just you're not organized. So this could be, you know, like you go with kind of the obvious, like what is something traditionally we've thought of as a way to stay organized? What's a filing cabinet? So possibly it gets pulled into the picture, and that's part of the bridge itself, is because you know that if you could just stay organized, and you hate it when the teacher says to turn something in and everyone's passing their work in and you just look with horror and have no clue that it was due. And then as people talk to you about it, you start to remember, you know, that that was something that had been asked for. Maybe your ride across the bridge is on making this up as an elephant. Why? I have no clue. But you have some reason why you like elephants, or the elephant means something. The elephant has a good memory. So maybe you have a great memory, and somehow that contrasts in a strange way with not being organized. So this is going to feel a little specific, but maybe you in your work you need to address the issue of sleep. It seems to be a big issue with students. Either they're getting too little, too much, wrong time of day, they can't sleep, they stay up through the night on their phone or different things, and then they try to function well in class and it becomes difficult. And I've watched, and I work hard to be entertaining in my class. I'm more laid back today as I'm teaching this material, but when I'm in class and I've watched the students are just struggling in my 5 minute, sometimes a short talk, just to keep their eyes open. And it's because they slept for an hour. I've talked to them about it, and it's impossible. You just can't function that way. So how do you hurdle that? How do you get over this issue? And I know in the past, historically, you know, people have been medicated when they just needed more sleep and or they needed exercise. There's some physical things that we can do that are real obvious, and sometimes we don't want to do them, so people will go and get medication for it. And sometimes the right choice is medication, so you got to be wise and you do need to do your research. So when I was in high school, I struggled staying awake. And so I started getting up in the morning and running 3 miles before school, and it went away. Like, I had no problem staying awake. And I don't even know if I understand the science behind that, but it made me much sharper through the day.